Methods of modulating outflow resistance. I have no conflict of interest. First, I want to talk about the substrate and location of outflow tract resistance. Second, about principles and algorithm, how to lower pressure, how to modulate it. First, medical modulation. Fourth, laser modulation, and fifth, surgical modulation. Substrate and location. Where is the outflow resistance? This is actually a puzzling question. The trabecular meshwork used to be the structure that was thought to be the primary outflow resistance, but the curious thing is that when this is removed in surgery, the pressure does not typically drop to the level of the episcleral venous pressure of around 8 millimeter mercury. And this is what you would basically predict based on the fact that the anterior chamber is connected through vessels with the episcleral veins. So where is the missing resistance that we don't know about? Here on the right, you see that the more advanced the glaucoma, the larger the pressure reduction after trabecular meshwork removal in one of our studies. This means that patients with a mildly diseased trabecular meshwork who have their meshwork removed get a small decrease, and patients with a large outflow resistance at the level of the trabecular meshwork can experience quite significant pressure drops. We found that in the porcine eye model, when the trabecular meshwork is removed, one can further drop the eye pressure by perfusing nitric oxygen. And this is surprising. It means that there must be a resistor somewhere in between the outer wall of Schlemm's canal and the episcleral veins that responds to nitric oxide in this experiment. Other labs have shown this as well, and I will show some data a few slides down the road. Principles and algorithms. Well, the guiding principle for doctors is the Hippocratic Oath. Primum non nocera, first do no harm. Anything that we do to lower pressure in a glaucoma patient has to be safe. That means if this is surgery, the surgical risk has to be low, and the postoperative risk also has to be low, because the story is not over with just the surgery being done. That might be the case with cataract surgery, but not with glaucoma surgery. And of course, this also applies to medications, to lasers, not just incisional surgery. It has to be effective. We now know that pressure really does need to be lowered by approximately 30%. This was debated. Some studies suggested maybe 20%, but really, the safe margin is at around 30%. And of course, it should be ideally below the normal average of healthy eyes, 50 millimeter mercury. There is a broken stick model that shows that initially the retinal nerve fiber layer gets lost and lost and lost, and there is basically no change in function in the visual field. But once there's a certain point reached at around 5 decibels, many patients experience a rather dramatic loss of function. So we need to lower the pressure below just the average pressure to prevent this from happening. And it has to be appropriate. Nobody wants to have a trabeculectomy if the glaucoma damage that's already manifested itself isn't really bad. On the other hand, lower risk procedures can be performed much earlier on in a glaucoma patient's career. The procedure has to be efficient. That means it can't be a terribly long surgery. Glaucoma is an increasing health problem, and many patients who have cataracts also have glaucoma. Approximately 20% in some studies do have also glaucoma. So it would be nice to combine the two, but you can't really combine the two if a surgery takes 2 hours. So just as a suggestion, the surgery should probably be below 30 minutes. And there are some that aren't. It can be, for instance, quite difficult to do a canaloplasty, although certainly there are people who do them in 20 minutes. And of course, it has to be economical. The material costs have to be low, whether this is the amount in implant costs or an eye drop or a laser that a practice wants to purchase to treat glaucoma. Any treatment has to also be economical for the patient. It is exhausting, intraoculectomies, for instance, to ask a patient to come back once a week for the first 1 or 2 months for micromanagement of the bleb. And it can be even more often. Some patients have to come back every other day initially when there are troubling issues with the wound healing. Of course, many clinics have developed an algorithm. We have one too. Basically a flow chart that standardizes care. And the most important part of any algorithm in the care of glaucoma is, of course, how urgent is the pressure? Is it a somewhat low pressure? Can you plan on maybe doing a laser trabeculoplasty that takes at least a couple of weeks to start to work significantly? Should one use eye drops to get an immediate effect, but then drops are oftentimes not the answer. They can be expensive, they can have systemic side effects. But at least they work right away. So for moderate glaucoma, moderately urgent IOP pressure situation, one should perhaps already schedule surgery and then add drops because they tend to work right away, except maybe prostaglandins. And one can add oral medications to have a more profound systemic effect. That is especially useful in patients who can't use drops too well for whatever reason, whether it's disability, whether there are just too many drops. But oral medications are poorly tolerated. Carbonic anhydrase inhibitors are something that many patients hate. And if the pressure situation is very urgent, with a high pressure, one can use IV medications to have an immediate and reliable onset. One would probably choose higher risk surgery. Let's take a look at all of these. First, let's start with something classic, medical modulation. The medications that change outflow resistance are quite a few. There are other substances like ethacrynic acid, but this is not really a medication, so I decided to just list medications here. Pilocarpine. Tension on the scleral spur and also on the trabecular meshwork by pulling on the scleral spur and through insertions from the ciliary body into the trabecular meshwork. Very nice study here that shows that even in the mouse, the facility increases and widens Schlemm's canal by pulling on the meshwork and the scleral spur. So the mouse might be a much better model than I used to appreciate in the past. Prostaglandins. That seems surprising to have them here in a list of outflow resistance, which implies the conventional outflow system, not the uveal scleral outflow. And of course, there's extracellular matrix throughout our bodies, including the trabecular meshwork. And lo and behold, latanoprost here in this study did lower the intraocular pressure in an ex vivo model without a ciliary body, where really only the trabecular meshwork is present as the most crucial tissue in this model, studied by a Baylor in the Johnson lab, late Johnson. And of course, these are just two eyes here, but this actually was repeated in eight eyes. So surprisingly, it works. And the late George Alvarado actually used prostaglandins to see whether SLT, selective laser trabecular plastic, would work. And his theory was that if I understood him correctly, that the extracellular matrix here would change and one could sort of predict what would happen with laser. But of course, laser is not really that dangerous, so why not just doing laser to start with? But it's an interesting theory and analogy that one could use maybe this and also laser, which we will review in just a second. Rho kinase inhibitors, a more recent addition to our portfolio of glaucoma medications, they relax the cytoskeleton. How can relaxation not be a good thing? They break down stress fibers. That sounds almost like a vacation. And they increase phagocytosis. Overall, I think it is fair to say most people expect it more clinically. One side effect in particular is eye reddening in many patients, and the pressure reduction is probably a little less than one would get, let's say, with timolol, a beta blocker that reduces aqueous humor production. But regardless, this is a very interesting class of medications and works in a completely different way. What we see here in one of our tissue culture models, the porcine eye model, with an induced glaucoma, or with an induced hypertension, I should say, from a very low-grade pigment dispersion, the pressure drops rather significantly, the blue line here, when the Rho kinase inhibitor RKI-1447 is given. So the Rho kinase inhibitors do all sorts of things. And the question is, why does this actually lower the pressure? Well, the trabecular meshwork remains an enigma. I don't think there is an easy answer for this. But fair enough to say that this Rho kinase inhibitor 1447 that we tested profoundly reduces the stress fiber and really does alter the cytoskeleton quite dramatically. This is perhaps surprising if pilocarpine would pull on the meshwork and reduces pressure by increasing conventional outflow. How can suddenly relaxing the same structure be having a similar effect? Here we see what happens if you add K115 to a pigmentary dispersion model. The pigment reduces the phagocytosis, and then adding the K115 increases the phagocytosis. Something similar happened here with this Rho kinase inhibitor in the, as far as migration is concerned, migration of trabecular meshwork cells, they suddenly start to migrate again after they slowed down with pigment. This we did not see with the RKI-1447, but of course, studies are not necessarily directly comparable. Here was pigment involved, and the effect isn't necessarily such a large one, although the bars certainly look like they do this here. Data that I haven't shown you from migration is sort of a borderline efficiency or impact on migration here as well. So mixed effect on migration. Let's just keep it that way. But there's something more interesting even happening, and that's a dilation of the distal outflow tract that you can see with Rho kinase inhibitors, at least with the nitarsidil that we tested here. The upper graph shows an increasing diameter of the collector channels. It's surprising that it would take that long, but they do continue to increase. The diameter only increases, however, at one concentration. This is the middle one here, 1.0 micromole. At 10 micromole, the diameter decreases. How could that possibly be? And not only that, but we have a pretty good correlation here with the intraocular pressure. The pressure actually increases at this higher concentration, where the diameter of the vessels decreases. That is, with the trabecular meshwork intact. So there seems to be some sort of downstream effect. Presumably, vessels constricting, pressure rises, or outflow facility decreases. There is a pressure reduction, as one would expect with the concentration that's used clinically. However, when the meshwork is removed, there's again a pressure reduction that can be induced. And there's again a pressure increase that we saw in this experiment after removal of the meshwork, presumably due to the constriction of these collector channels or downstream vessels. These are complex mixed effects, but one could perhaps speculate that it's not just an inhibition of Rho kinase. It's known that Rho kinase inhibitors have also an inhibition on of the norepinephrine transporter, and so it is possible that these vessels constrict at a higher dose because there's more of an effect of a constriction. That would, of course, clinically not be great news if there's a relatively small window of increasing the pressure versus decreasing, but at least that's what we found in this tissue culture model. Dilating with nitric oxide works in a similar fashion. After removal of the trabecular meshwork, one can still see a drop. One can see in red here the overlay vessels dilate. When one has acquired all the lovely 3D data of a complex outflow system, then there's nothing preventing you from trying to model flow. We've tried that, computational fluidics, using our OCT data, and we're using here a vector technique where the flow is modeled, and you can see that, for instance, the flow speed here in the center is the highest, as one would typically expect in any vessel. But one could try to find certain pinch points, and you do actually find them. This is relatively preliminary data, but there are some elements that seem to be pinch points that can be dilated and can be constricted in the outflow tract in the porcine eye model. We haven't done the same with human eyes. Of course, there's an issue with freshness of a tissue, but it seems like that there are some regulatory elements that can constrict and dilate depending on what medication you give them. So perhaps this is not just a dump tubing system, but actually a system that can regulate flow, not just at the level of the meshwork, but also downstream. Laser modulation. Okay, that is perhaps a surprise, but I still felt I needed to include this because I was asked to talk about modulation. ALT, an old classic, that's the argon laser trabeculoplasty. 50 micron shots in the meshwork. They can create big craters. They have a coagulative damage of a tissue that's permanent. There is a scar. Curiously enough, they create sort of herniations of the meshwork into Schlemm's canal. How that lowers pressure is a mystery if you see these histology pictures, but it becomes more clear looking at SLT, which is just as effective, not more effective, not less effective, but lowers pressure just to the same extent, a little bit better than eye drops, and cheaper, and of course great for a patient who doesn't have to use drops if that works. SLT has larger spots. They can be around 200 to 300 micron. They're placed next to each other along the meshwork. You don't see anything in electron microscopy. I cannot show you real histology, but this is again electron microscopy, but a higher level. It's called selective laser trabeculoplasty because this erbium laser is absorbed primarily by pigment. The biological effect is TM cell division, migration, phagocytosis. That sounds awfully similar to what the Rho kinase inhibitor does. But of course, this is much more than that. There are also inflammatory substances. TNF alpha is induced. Most of all, matrix metalloproteinases are upregulated that break down the extracellular matrix, in particular stromalicin and gelatinase 1. Surgical modulation. This is more of a focus of later talks, but I think this is important to point out here that there's a high risk group of surgical devices and surgery modalities, tube shunts, micro shunts, the PreserFlow, the Zen gel shunt, that basically drain the fluid from the anterior chamber into a pocket underneath the conjunctiva. Classical trabeculectomy does the same thing. And that means there is basically nothing from reaching pressures as low as zero because, there is no other pressure on the other side, really. Here are flow restrictor systems, of course, that make them a little more safe. Suprachoroidal drainage is something that is unfortunately not looking so good anymore. The graveyard of implants is large. This is the gold shunt. This is the CyPass, a $500 million, very promising project, not just project, a clinical device that I implanted, that many people implanted. Alcon brought this to market, but unfortunately it didn't deliver. There was some endothelial damage and a mixed bag as far as the pressure is concerned. You see this inserted on the inside of the eye, underneath the sclera, where a fluid lake forms, and that's then absorbed in the suprachoroidal space, a potential space that doesn't exist until you stick something into it. That sounds new and exciting, but really it's an old kind of surgery, cyclodialysis clefts, where some of the earliest pressure-lowering interventions, one would basically stick a metal prong in there and then open this space bluntly so the fluid could trickle in, but unfortunately that closes, so the pressure is either too low, even close to zero, or then if the space closes, it jumps right up to a very high level. Here is a nice collection of terrible complications, from flat chambers over leaking blebs to kissing choroidals, eroding hardware, endophthalmitis and blebitis. Not to underestimate how common this actually is. We all live as glaucoma surgeons in denial that this would happen to our patients until it then hits the statistical number that happens every 1,000, 3,000 patients, and then one realizes that this is really a potentially pretty dangerous surgery. This here is basically showing you the epibulbar glaucoma surgeries that are riskier. But there is news. Well, by now they're not that new anymore, but they are Schlemm's canal implants, the Hydrus, the iStent, second generation, first generation. They're placed from the inside, ab interno, through the meshwork, and allow better flow. Here on the right, something that's potentially better because you don't leave an implant behind. Biofilms can coat these implants and occlude the lumen. There can be fibrosis. They're basically it's a foreign body in an eye, so why would the body not react to them? You can remove a meshwork in various ways or disrupt it. An old standard that's now 17 years old is the trabectome. There is the Trabex, now manufactured by the same company that purchased the trabectome, or the Cahook dual blade. They're very similar. One has irrigation, the Cahook blade doesn't, but other than that, they can excise the meshwork. And there are the disrupting techniques. Here is the so-called GAT, gonioscopy-assisted transluminal trabeculotomy, where you thread a suture through Schlemm's canal, hope that it goes all the way around, and then tear it through. And you can do the same with a device that's called TRAP 360. The disadvantage of disruption is the lips of the disrupted meshwork are still there and potentially they can close. As far as extent of access to the drainage segments is concerned, the little implants give you in average about 60 degrees of access to drainage segments, because there are many septations, as you can see here with the SD-OCT scan. You see here the aqueous pathways. The sclera has been sort of subtracted, calculated away. And that means past the endpoints of an ablation or disruption that you're able to do, maybe with a trabectome, for instance, or the coke plate, you do get an extra 30 degrees roughly. So really, if you are able surgically to do 180 degrees, you get another 60 from your ablation end. So that's not quite 360, but there are companies marketing their instruments as a 360 procedure. The difference between 360 and 240, if you do the math, is not really that large. Okay, how do the complications compare? Well, the trabectome, as the oldest, most mature technology, has a large database, a track record of basically not being very dangerous at all. It's almost comparable to cataract surgery, except there are some psychodialysis clefts. There can be malignant glaucoma, because this is a glaucoma patient population. We examined around 1,000 patients and found very few serious complications. Most people had some sort of microhyphema because the meshwork is gone. The blood simply flows back right after surgery, but it's transient. Trabeculectomies and tube shunts are in a completely different ball league there. Traps needed 74% of additional procedures here in the well-known TVT study. Tubes only 27%. Late complications, early complications here. Again, the tube shunts do better than the traps. That's also the reason why they became more popular in the United States. The primary TVT study that was done by the same investigators, but there were other centers involved, didn't really produce such a big difference again. But so they were more similar, but the tubes still handled a little easier. So I think they remain a favorite, because with traps you have to see patients every week and inject them with 5FU to manage the scar tissue, and with tube shunts you basically just sit there and add medications if necessary. Okay, how effective can trabecular meshwork removal actually be? It can be quite effective. Here is a study that we did in patients who had failed trabeculectomy, so serious glaucoma. And just removing the meshwork allowed these patients to have a pretty significant pressure drop. Not episcleral venous pressure. It might be not low enough long term for them, but this was at least a 1-year study, and the pressure remained low in most of these patients. And one thought in the past that once you've bypassed the conventional outflow system, it would atrophy and you could never restore it, but the fact is you can remove the meshwork and still get flow through the conventional outflow system. This is visible if you use a tracer. We use 5-FU fluorescein here, and you can see in this pig eye that's looking in the camera, a sort of even filling, but right after the ablation there is a very rapid nasal filling. They're starting at the same time, so super physiological flow here, and although there's only ablation along the nasal side, there is really circumferential flow, as one can show with sort of computational approaches by showing where exactly the flow happens. Circumferential flow, faster and brighter. That's different when you use something else, an ice tent for instance. The flow is much more limited naturally because that's basically sort of the 60 degrees that one would expect due to the septations. Well, time to summarize. We talked about the substrate and the location of the outflow track resistance that these glaucoma eyes encounter, and it's puzzling. Certainly the trabecular meshwork is very important. Maybe one can call it primary, but in many patients, and I haven't shown you the data here because this is not the talk about the anatomy, there is a very significant distal outflow resistance. Some patients get no effect after trabecular meshwork removal. Principles and algorithms, reduce risk. This is very, very important. We have to keep this in mind also with medications, of course, but risk reduction is important. Medical modulation, we saw substances with proximal and distal effects. Rho kinase inhibitors do have very clear distal effects, so they're attractive. NO, of course, can also be delivered as a secondary molecule, for instance, with prostaglandin analogs. Laser modulation, that's the everything bagel. One gets matrix metalloproteinase, upregulation, TM cell division, migration, phagocytosis. Surgical modulation, epibulbar and suprachoroidal, both are higher risk. One really does only epibulbar surgery nowadays anymore. And then the a group of mixed that are basically very low risk are the ones that enhance the natural conventional outflow. I want to thank you. I want to point out, of course, there are many lab members who worked on these projects and many collaborators, and none of this would have been possible without the funding that we had received. Thank you.